having my call. Derek Kisser is here, by the way, trying to stand in for him, which is a painful job because, as you heard, I'm only still flossing with the Swedish song, and here, I don't know how many years, but quite a few more. I still try to learn what's going on in the library industry. And one thing that I was running across here was there is this belief that if you tan a letter and you use chromium salt and you do that in combination with certain other chemistries, that you have the possibility that you produce chromium 6. And that's of course a very well researched area. But I was thinking, if that's so, why do we only measure chromium 6? Because if I'm one of those ingredient manufacturers, I actually would like to understand if you get the reaction from chromium 3 to chromium 6 on one hand, and on the other hand you have the other chemistry that is taking part of that, do I have a measure of measuring what's going on the other hand of the equation? And that is really what this is, speech, what this presentation is about. So my colleague is always good in finding thought-provoking pictures. And this is German. We heard something about chromium before. I'm not going to dive further into that. This I find interesting. It's a quote from somewhere. And it says, however, the leather manufacturers fail to explain that chromium 3 oxidizes into chromium 6 in the presence of oxygen combined with other factors such as extremes in pH. And then in blue, this happens during the tanning process. Chromium 10th leather can contain between 4 to 5% of chromium, often hexafluoride chromium. Yeah. And you read it as if it is a fact, because it's quoted, right? But is it really a fact? That's the kind of things that I like to dig out with my team and within our company. One of the other things that I find confusing is that if you have the chromium 3 to chromium 6 process on the one hand, and you have the fat oxidation or lipid oxidation on the other hand, which one is the oxidator and which one is the reductor? In fact, chromium 6 is a very strong oxidizing agent. When you see the half cell, you see it down below. It doesn't make sense. Chromium 6 actually will fall back immediately and will help stabilize the fat or the lipid. So what's going on? Earlier this morning we had this fantastic speech on char and the chromium carbide. There are two elements in the difference between chromium 6 and chromium 3 which are important to me. One is more soluble in water than the other. And we always have a certain amount of water in the leather. And the other one is so it's soluble and it will have ionic species. And the other one is chromium 3 actually has the tendency of forming complexes. The chromium 6 does not to the same extent. So this is one hand of the equation. The other hand of the equation is, so lipids, what about lipids? Well, lipids are very sensitive. If you look at your butter, if you keep that too long at too high temperatures or there's a lot of light, it will go rancid. There's an oxidation happening. That has also been very well researched. It's a three-step, and three-step sounds very easy, but if you really look deeper, there's an awful lot of chemistry going on, especially in the propagation step. For the initiation, so for the full oxidation process of the lipids to start, you need to initiate. And for the initiation, you need an event, and this can be enzymatic, or it can be reactive oxygen specimen, as they call it. These are different compounds. So those compounds, they can be created by light, heat, metal ions, excited oxygen states. So if that all is happening and the reaction starts, then depending on the temperature you will primarily provide peroxides or hydroperoxides, or at higher temperatures you will get more aldehydes, carbonyls, ketones, and those are actually the ones that will generate some of the off smell flavors. On the right, you see a schematic of a lipid, and you see the double bonds. And what's mentioned there is how much energy do you need to have to abstract a hydrogen from the chain. And what you observe is that if you're actually at the C, which deals in the double bond, you need a very high amount of energy. If you actually are at the C, at the carbon adjacent to that double bond, the energy lowers quite significant. And this is what you are looking at, is the background why unsaturated lipids have a higher tendency to oxidize. Meaning that they can only be oxidized because if there are no double bonds, as long as you provide enough heat, enough energy, you will have a tendency to oxidize. So saturated or unsaturated, both are oxidizable. And the amount is actually controlled by the amount of energy that you need. In this thing, this can also be catalyzed. And one of the things that it can be catalyzed by is by metals. And the combination of metals and the amount of moisture in your leather has a certain impact on this. So on the left, you can see the further schematic, and you see the abstraction of the hydrogen. You produce a free a radical, very active site, and then with oxygen, you get a peroxyl radical. And that peroxyl radical then is capable enough to attack another lipid and cause that again and cause it again. And that's the auto-oxidation, it's the propagation reaction. In that reaction, as soon as you get very reactive species like hydroxyl with a half time of less than a nanosecond, so you know, even with the blink of your eye, it has already turned its back and starts to react. And some of the others are actually taking part in getting the chromium 3 to chromium 6. So it's not the initial oxidation of the lipid. Now back to what we want to accomplish, what we want to research, is if you measure chromium 6, and there's the ISO standard for that, how do you actually measure the oxidation of a lipid? And that turns out not to be an easy thing if you really want to measure a certain species. Because in the propagation, you need to imagine there's a cloud of different reactions taking place. So which species are you actually going to measure? We went for a very straightforward and relatively simple test. It's a oxygen consumption test, and what you have is you have a cylinder which is closed. You put in your stuff that you want to measure, and you bring an overpressure of oxygen in there. And then what you will see is in time nothing happens until the oxygen is actually consumed in the propagation reaction. And at that point, oxygen from the environment is pulled, and this actually lowers the overpressure. And that point is then called the induction point, and you can measure the induction point quite easily, straightforward from the graph. It says here two responses. We build a test design. This is a bit of my history. I once had the opportunity to do black belt training. I can recommend that, by the way, to every student. Once you have, you know, your analytical understanding, your process understanding, as soon as you start to go testing, try to get some of the Six Sigma. And best is even if you go black belt training. Very straightforward, full factorial design, three factors, so you get a kind of a cube. And what you do with the factors is set them at a low and a high level. Very simple. And then you get this this table. We did the eight runs. We did it in duplicates, so we replicated it. And we took as factors, we took the type of the fat. So looking at how much unsaturation is there. We looked at the concentration of the inhibitor. How this is an ingredient that actually inhibits the oxidation of the lipid. And we looked at the application recipe we did with and without reflowing. The beauty of a full factorial design is you have the design up front, you run the test, you fill in the data, you actually get information on what are the main effects, what is not the main effect. And for those that are interested, full design, factorial design, it also gives you information about the interaction. And the interaction is if the effect of one factor, if this is the effect going from a low level to a high level, and then depending on the level of the other factor, you get something like this. If you don't do these signs, you don't know what to think of your data that you obtain. But if you do it in the design, you actually will find this interaction, and you can further research. Well, luckily for us, we didn't find any interaction, so we can only look at the main effects. And here you see the main effects for the chrome 6 and for the oxygen. So we have both of the responses. And these are relative numbers. And what you will see is going from the low level to the high level, you actually see for the unsaturation, it has a dramatic impact on the oxygen consumption. So what this says is low level, low unsaturation. And low unsaturation, you have a long induction point, and this is what you expect. If you have more unsaturated groups, you find a shorter induction point, so you would actually expect lower levels. And this is what's happening in that direction. And the same is true, but of course opposite for the chromium 6. I skipped a slide. I started off that I want to know the relation between one hand of the equation and the other hand of the equation. And this is actually the answer. So if you put both responses against each other, you find that it looks like a decent fit. There is, of course, some variation in there, and if you like designs, you are happy with variation, because it means that you're looking at real data. And this is a quadratic fit, but if you do a linear fit in here, it would only drop 1 or 2%. So an 89% fit tells us something, but still doesn't tell us what's going on behind it. But what it does tell me, this whole exercise, is that next to chromium 6, I now have another test available, which I can use, and it's a very simple test, to look at other parameters that actually influence the whole thing. So coming to the conclusion, we found a correlation of 89%. We found that the unsaturation has is a main effect, has a significant impact. We found that inhibition has a significant impact. And under the current settings, with and without regrowing, has little or no effect. I do want to make a statement that diving into this, I found that the chemistry is very complex. I do not pretend that I know every step. I know the kinetics nor the thermodynamics. But as an engineer, you start on the outside and you go deeper and deeper. Still researching this, although it's a well-researched area, I still find that there's a high probability for a better understanding so that we can develop more and better robust practices to even lower the probability of growing resistance. Because if you ask me personally, that is really what it is all about. That was the presentation. Thanks for your attention.